Okay, let's get started again. So, I think everyone should be able to use R or invoke R to read HTTP ASCII format. Okay. Now, without going into detail how we construct the code, and when you return to your institution, and I hope that you will spend more time to learn R on your own. I don't think that's difficult to learn. It's difficult to start. Once you start it and you become used to, it should be pretty easy. Okay, so let me repeat. So when you invoke R, you have to load R code. By doing that, you type source, web parentheses, and the name of the code got to be enclosed by either single quote or double quote. Okay, as we did, or everybody know that. So let's move to another hands-on exercise. This is exercise 3.6. It's very similar to what we showed you earlier, except this is running from a script. Okay, at the Linux command line. Okay, let me try to open it up. Okay, so this is in the window environment, you are able to run in a script from the command line, but it's relatively complicated. Okay, and it's not a good time to tell you what to do right now, but I briefly show you how to run. I show you how to run from the Linux command line. It's much easier for me to give a demo on doing this. Okay, so what I will do, I will just go return to my connection to my server over there. Okay, actually this one, yeah, and. Okay, so we are in. I'm logging as user 09 to server over there, and everybody already logged into as using your own username. So this is user 09. Okay, it's in the G training directory. I just copy some file over there, which we left before the lunch break. Let me show you the gtspp2.txt.per. As I told you earlier, the first thing you have to do, you don't know the script, you just get to see the head menu by typing this h after your program name. So that will give you a bunch of options, what you can do for gtspp2.txt. So I hope there are some files already there, but I can copy over. Okay, .meds. Okay, so if there's one file, to pick up this one as an example. Okay, there's one file. I think the same file you already have on your desktop. Okay, so this is the file we're going to display. So what I have to do, I just say gtspp2txt.per/input file will be data / gtspp and followed by a database ID 10316785.meds, and I like to see in text mode, so I just said -txt, or you can say this time let's try CSV. Okay, it's a comma separate value. Okay, and if I didn't type the output name, and I think it will show you to the screen. So let's see what happened. I didn't type the -o. See? So I like to save to a file. So as I say, -o output. So I give them a name for output, say temp.out. No, I give any name. So it's done. Okay, so take a look on the temp.out. Okay. So this is output looks like comma separate. Instead of just plain text. So it's it's all the field separated by comma. So this kind of format can be read into any spreadsheet software. For example, Microsoft Excel. Okay, and they can do a really funny thing from there. So this is a translation from main ASCII to comma separate value, which can be easily loaded into, for example, Microsoft spreadsheet format, but not ODB. So later on, I will show you how to convert from MET ASCII to ODB expressive format, which you, later on you can use ODB to load. And okay, so this just gave you a demo how to use GTAPP to TXT Perl script. And when you return to your institution, you can ask your system person to install Linux. You already have Linux, and that's much easier. The Perl is a built-in package for any Linux system. Okay, so the files there, and you can use later on. So this is kind of a little bit sidetrack about using GTAPP Perl script to decode ASCII format. Okay, let's move on. For R, okay, now I'd like to give you a demo how to run R in Linux environment. Okay, you know how to run in Windows environment, but this is going to give you how to run R in Linux, in particular in batch mode. Okay, so the batch command to run is called the R script. Okay, now I can do R from here, since this is a kind of Linux like. I can do R from here, okay. But this is still like a command line mode. I can do the same thing as you did, you know, when your window or environment. I can just say source, as we did, you know, earlier. Say source, source, and the dash. I use GTSPP. No, I'm sorry. Called the read, uppercase. PPASCII.R. Okay, you don't have to end it with uppercase R, anything you like, but it's a convention most people use. Okay, and then you say, so it's done. So it's the same as you use in Windows environment. So I'm going to quit R either from at the command line, you already say R, and you already say quit, Q for quit, and end up with parentheses. Okay, now we quit. And it will ask you want to save in workspace image to save what you did not before. And normally, to me, I would just say no. Okay, because I already start with a new section. So this is the end of the section. So the system will ask you to unsave the workspace. Okay, so you don't have to say yes. No, so you say yes, let me save workspace. And this time, you invoke R. Now we stay from where you left. So it's not a good idea to do that, because sometimes you want to do a new thing. No? You want to continue from what you left. So normally I just say, no, I don't want to save image. But the same thing, when you quit window version, you have to say Q, you know, parentheses, and they will ask you to save or not to save. Why would I give them a try? Okay, right now type Q, parentheses, from your window environment, and you can come back later on. So this is an exercise how to invoke R and exit R. Right? Okay, so later on, we will come back, return to R. Okay. So to run R either in a window environment as you see used in the PC window, or you can run from a scripts. So let's say I run from batch mode interactive. I don't want to go to R environment. I just say run from the command line, from the Linux command line, and the next command called R scripts. T. And follow that, I will need a script name. In this case, it will be read GTSPP ASCII.R. See? The same thing. So instead of using R and go to the R environment, which is R and the type source, okay, so and then followed by the file name, okay. So instead of going into the R environment, we run R from the command line, which this is the Linux command line, okay. The dollar sign here, right? Do you see dollar sign? Maybe too small for you to see. So the system designed to tell you who is logged in. So right now, you see the USR09 is the username at Sunrise. It's my computer name called the Sunrise, or the IP address. But in this case, we show the computer name. Okay, and the below that, it will tell you the location where you actually are. Okay, so right now I'm under the G training subdirectory. So squiggle dash indicate your home directory. Okay, so to invoke R, you can run from here, as I showed you earlier. You just say R script and followed by the R script name. Okay, so this is what we will exercise 6.4. Okay. Now, convert GDPP ASCII to TSV. Okay. Now, I will ask you to try it. Okay. Try the same thing. So you invoke your R environment, the R window. Click on your R icon and bring the R window back. Okay. Go ahead and do that. Click to bring the R window back by typing R from your command line. And I will do it from my command line, but you do from your R environment. You bring your R window. Okay, which you did, right? So I'm going to run from Linux. It should be the same. But Linux don't have a very fancy interface. No, it's just a plain screen. So what you have to do, after you bring the R, you just say source to run the program. Source, type, go ahead and type source. And then say GTSPP to convert from GTPP to odv.r. Okay, and just hit enter. It's taking a while to run because conversion from one format to odv is relative. It depends on the file built into the GTPP to odv is. I should take a look first before I try this, but you know, anyway, it's running right now. Okay, I can take a look from here, see what's the file name. Okay, the Mac version of the PowerPoint won't allow me to look in the hyperlink. No, cannot create a hyperlink, so okay. So mine is done. I can take a look because I forgot what's inside the code. Okay. Let me take a quick look on the data file. pp2odv.r. Okay, let me do this way. Okay, let's take a look on the GTAPP2odv, the Perl scripts. Okay. So this program read, there's a data file called GTAPP. Did you see that? Because this reading file from data directory, and there's a file name called GTAPP dash underscore, actually underscore DM, which means delay mode, underscore CD, which means CDD down, and in 2012.mets. Okay, so this convert. This file from made ASCII of GDPP ASCII into TS on the ODV spreadsheet. So this is the input file, and in R, this is an open file, connection. Stands for con. Can you read that? Okay, let's begin now. So con means connection. Okay, you can make any name you like, say file name, like variable name. So this means I assign a file located in data directory with the file name is this, okay? And assign to a variable called a file. I make a connection to that file using file. This one is a R syntax. Means make a connection within a plain text, ASCII format. Okay, and that's another format reading compressed, which is good for GTAPP, I mean for R. So normally when you work on a compressed GIF file, you have to ngip first. But R has the utility allow you to, you don't have to ngip first. You check, they can read the compressed file, which is good. But in this case, since this file is a text file, so we use file, very, very simple, to make a connection and assign to a variable called con. Okay, so this one, read lines, is a R syntax, is a R statement, is a read file 9x9. Okay, so later on you can look into the note which I told you yesterday. I prepared a note. So all what I talk here is in that kind of one, a three-page, you know, note. Okay, so the read line is the R syntax reading sample plain text file 9x9. Okay, so I read everything 9x9 into a variable called data. Okay, you can name anything you like, and I close the connection. Okay, now there's another subroutine called GTAPP to ODV, which is stored in this file. Okay, but the function name called GTAPP to ODV, it's just a name for that component, and read into a data array. This is a R variable, R data type. It's easy. It's not so difficult to understand, but I, because of time limit, I don't want to go too detail about that. Write is another Linux, another R command, allow you to write your data into a spreadsheet format. Okay. Oh, and this is called GTAPP. Right now, we convert from this file, this format, main ASCII to this one. So this is how the Arch works. So let's take a look on the convert file, okay, which is in the data directory. I think this is also included in your data, directory. Okay, so just take a quick look on this one, GTAPP, which we just convert. Okay, so this format is much simpler than MetaSCII. Okay, instead of very detailed metadata information, how this data has been processed, how many texts has been performed, is it good, is it passed or failed. So this is just simple display or convert the data from MetaSCII and to preserve the actual data and also quality flag. Okay, so I can tell this is the CUS ID. Okay, and this could be, this is here, this is CUS ID, and this is staging type. So the second line, the first line, the first line is here, it's a special ODV, Ocean Data View Text. We have to tell ODV, this is just a missing value, everything appeared as 999.90. That's the missing value. Okay, so below that, you have the title label for each column, because spreadsheet is sorted by column. So look like the first column or first field is called a CUS ID. So this is the ODV preserved keyword. So once you ODV read CUS, no, okay, this is the CUS ID. And then when you go to the next one, oh, what happened? Okay. So this one will CUS ID. Okay, and now will be station. This is GTAPP station ID. Okay. I have been working with Renner from Germany. He is the author for the ODV. So the convention is totally follow the ODV convention. So the two GTAPP and ODV are fully compatible right now. So we use the GTAPP database ID as the station in ODV. Okay, and this is the data type. You know, the CTD down, and after that you got the year, and this is the GTAPP. This is a standard ISO date time convention. And there will be longitude, you know, as you see here, this the second one will be longitude, and after that will be latitude, and run a QC flag. So you have to say QV, that's a quality value for GTAPP. Otherwise, the ODV cannot recognize this column. So you have to say QV, GTAPP, and so forth. So this is a much simpler format and allow you to, and you can load into Microsoft Excel as well, if you like. Okay. So without going to detail, I stop here because later we're going to have exercise how to load GTPP ASCII, not ASCII, GTPP spreadsheet format into ODB. The one task you can do later on, you already create a file in the area of interest. The file then right now is called GTPP data.meds. Okay. So for your exercise, you don't have to do right now, but that's the data side, that's the data set I like you to work on offline, not now, offline, during the break or whatever time. Convert that format using this software, but you have to make edit, you have to make change the input file. Okay. Let me show you where you have to make edit. Okay. Okay. Now, you have to find a way to make change on the input file. Right now, this program on your desktop is assigned to GTPP underscore DM underscore GD underscore 2012.mat. So you have to modify this line to read the data that you just retrieved from GTPP website. Right now, the file name called GTPP, I believe the default is called GTPP data.mats. So that should be very easy for you. But you have to, I will let you figure out how to do it. Basically, you have to do is invoke or bring the R window up, and there's a file, menu on the upper left. Click on one and open and do editing. Okay. So you can not. Don't try it right now. You can try it later on, and if you have a problem, and I can work with you to do that. Okay, so that's one of the task. Allow every one of you to get a presentation. Okay, to convert the file you already download in MetaASCII format using GTPP to ODB.R program to convert that format into ODB format. Tomorrow I'm going to telling you how to load that format into ODB. Okay, so that's tomorrow, probably tomorrow afternoon. Okay, so should be prepared now to do that in the, on last day presentation. Okay, so I guess this should be good for now for the ASCII. Okay, yeah, okay. Okay, this should be good for now. So before we move to the next topics, and any question for anything so far for me? Me or for Bob. Before we move, no. I don't want to move too fast, but I don't want to slow down either. So okay, I like to make sure that everybody has a question or don't get a question. No question is good. No question is good. No question is good too. So okay, so let's move to the next topic, which is called NetCD file. Okay. No, not this one. This is wrong. Okay. Now, this could be another challenge for every one of you, because it's how many people you know NetCD? What that stands for? Or is the first time you heard about it, NetCD? Raise your hand. Don't be shy. Okay, so I assume this could be either the second time. How about that? Okay, you heard Bob say earlier this morning, so that's your first time. This is your second time. Okay, so what is NetCD? Yeah, okay. So what is NetCD? What's the component of NetCD? I'm talking about NetCD 3 versus NetCD 4. And the convention that commonly used right now, what's going on, the community using NetCDF, and how to read or how to write, and the software will include to tell you how to manipulate or display NetCDF data. Okay, so this is the outline for this section. Okay, so what is NetCDF? So NetCDO stands for Network, comma, Data Form. So that will be N as a process. NE is a process actually. NET as a process related. Oh, I don't like this one. Okay. The NET. Okay, that will be the NET. C, the coming from the NetCDO, CDF. So NetCDO stands for Network, comma, Data Form. Okay. It's the interface for array-oriented data access and the library that provide an implementation of the interface. Bear that in mind. So NetCDO should be array-oriented. Then what does that really mean to you? You have a single value, say 10, number 10. So it's a constant. Right, it's just a variable called constant or 10. But in NetCDF sense, that's going to be array. So this is a special array with only one single value. Okay, and a lot of people get confused or forgot about the definition of NetCDF or the intention of NetCDF. That's the beauty for NetCDF because it's built based on the assumption that everything is in array, is a vector, so forth. Okay, so bear that in mind, because I have been run into an extensive discussion with other people. They say, why is only single value and you treat single value as an array? No, you are idiot. I said, no, it's not. I'm not idiot. Because based on definition of NetCDF, everything got to be in an array, even if there's one single value. Okay? So NetCDF was developed and is maintained at the Unidata. They're part of the University Corporation for Atmospheric Research, or UCA for short. So it's still ongoing activity, and it's been going on for more, almost, I would say somewhere 20 years. It's a while. The way I see the NetCDF is primarily designed for the scientist. It's not for designed for ordinary people. Let's say when you're using a text, plain text file, your eye can see it. This is a text file. I can see it. Okay. So most people feel more comfortable doing the text file in a text format, which means I can see it. So I feel comfortable with seeing it. This is not a way to do business, okay, particularly in ocean science. The reason why, because you work on the text file, is sometimes the file becomes too large. It's not easy to manipulate. Okay, and so people moving from text file going into binary, which is only machine readable, and the people are getting nervous because they don't feel comfortable because they cannot see it. It's only machine can see it, but it's faster. It's more efficient to read data in binary than in ASCII file or text file. When model generate file, they most likely generate in binary file. It's easy read and write. However, for binary file, there's a problem with binary file. It's machine dependent. They say the model is generated on a Linux PC or on a Linux machine. They might have a problem to read into a Macintosh or MacBook or PC. So binary is not compatible. So the good thing for NetCDF is compatible. It's shareable, as I say here. It's shareable. You can share among any type. Okay, it's safe description. When you give data, you are not just going to give people data only. We like to give people about the data, which means metadata. So all the metadata information can be included in NetCDF file. Okay. So that's the first reason. It's safe description. It's all metadata in one place, not just data only. It's portable, it's machine portable. You can do it from here to there, no problem. You get direct access. You go, you don't have to start from beginning to the end. We want to read one file. That's what happened in the text file. In the plain text, you have to read it from the 9.1 all the way down. Okay. But in NetCDF, you can jump around. You can move from one to layer, one to A, whatever. And it's always appendable. You can add more to the end of the file and the archivable. I'm not quite sure the last one is a good statement. Archivable. It's archive NetCDF file. Okay. I'm not fully convinced that NetCDF file, but I copy because maybe everybody said it's archivable. So I kind of share their view. But personally, I really don't feel comfortable just store necessary as archive, unless the necessary file has been commonly used by everybody. Okay, right now I see that's a long way to go. And when you run into NetCDF, you always run into a lot of compatibility issues. It's not always backward compatible. The software writer for one NetCDF file, it may not be, once the NetCDF file changed, this software is no longer usable. So in that regard, I don't see right now, at least for now, it's not ready yet for use NetCDF file as an archive format. So the component of NetCDF file, there are three basic components. The first one called the dimensions, the second one called the variable, and the very last one is the attribute. So what the attribute means? Attribute is the metadata information about your variable. Okay. So dimension, you know, dimension, as we said earlier, NetCDF file is in array. So it got to be either one dimension or two dimension, and so forth. Okay. Now we're talking about the dimension and coordinate system. So a coordinate variable is a one-dimensional variable with the same file name as a dimension, but it must be strictly monotonic. Got the increase in one direction, increase or decrease in one direction. Okay, and so we need a coordinate variable in the NetCDF file. Okay, so there's a two, right now there's two versions. The first one called NetCDF 3, actually more precisely should be 3.6, okay. And the unit data keep changing the way they call the NetCDF data type. So right now, the most precisely say, we call the classic data model. It used to be called NetCDF 3. So either NetCDF 3 or classic data model, that's kind of interchangeable. The newer version called NetCDF 4, okay, it's called the comma data model. Okay, so I just list the permit the similarity between those two. So the 3 and the 4 always has dimension, variable, and attribute. The only unique to NetCDF 4 has another area called the group. Okay, so you can create a group. And right now, GTAPP NetCDF format stay with NetCDF 3 for one reason. Because, as I said earlier, sometimes your software is written for 3, you have difficulty to read NetCDF 4. So right now, not everyone writes software for NetCDF 4 yet. Okay, so that was my suggestion to the GTAPP group last week. We will stay with NetCDF 3 until NetCDF 4 software is more commonly used. Then we can switch into NetCDF 4. So right now, GTAPP will stay NetCDF 3 for a while. Okay. So this is the combination. This is a comparison between NetCDF 3 and NetCDF 4. Another reason for going to NetCDF 4 is they have more than one dimension for unlimited. Right now, GTAPP only have one unlimited dimension in history group. Okay, but you move to NetCDF 4, you can have more than one dimension as unlimited dimension. And also another feature for GTAPP for NetCDF 4 is the parallel I/O. Okay, you can read right now. Normally, I/O stands for input output. You always go to one by one only, but NetCDF will allow you to do more than one read or more than one write. They call them parallel I/O, and there's a people concerned about the speed for being using the parallel I/O. They will slow down your process a lot, so they are not really recommend using NetCDF yet. Okay. So the convention, this is the convention. Normally, you need to say convention equal to CF. CF stands for climate forecast. Okay, and it used a lot in the community. So you will hear a lot say the CF convention or CF compatible, which means CF, which means the climate forecast convention. And right now, they have CF-1.6. Okay. So So there are a lot of conventions, you know, on in the community right now. So the first one commonly kind of follow convention called the Climate and Forecast Metadata Convention. And the second one, you probably hear a lot, called the ACDD, the Attribute Convention for Dataset Discover Convention. Okay. And you've got Argo NACDF, you've got GDPP, you've got another additional. There are tons of the NACDF convention. So it's almost each project has their own convention. And everybody almost claim they are CF compatible or fully in compliance with the CF or ACDD, which I always keep my finger crossed. They are not really fully compatible with CF. Okay. I have been carefully follow the CF convention, but I still have difficulty to follow it because it changed rapidly. It just changed from 1.6 to whatever. So we try our best to keep GDPP, NACDF convention, follow CF, and even not just CF, but also ACDD. And that was the funny, very funny thing about convention. And we, GDPP, start using NACDF back into probably 1992, in the early worst day. So we got the first version. Yeah, that's somewhere there. So we got the first version, NACDF come out. At that time, we work with the WOS, which stands for the World Ocean Circulation Experiment. There are a lot of data type, you know, satellite, sea level, ocean current, thermal graph, and so forth. So we had a convention called WOS Convention, W-O-C-E, WOS Convention, okay, which was officially announced at the end of the WOS, which was in 1999, officially ended 2000, is that correct? Yeah, 1999. So we have WOS Convention available, which GTAPP is part of the WOS Convention. Okay. At that time, we don't have CF Convention at all. Okay, so the first NACDF Convention was WOS. The WOS ended. So no one in charge of WOS Convention. Okay, later on, the ARGO came along. So we got the ARGO convention. The ARGO kind of follow WOS. So the WOS, ARGO, GDPP, we are coming from the same source. So more or less, they are in the same structure. Couple years after, people create the CF convention, which is roughly totally different. They get quite different. The similarity between CF or definition with CF and the WOS or ARGO is somehow really confused. And I was not so happy, but not one man cannot do too many things. I just keep myself say, why you create a new claim convention? We want to have a WOS. And there was a lot of software written based on the WOS convention. Look like ODV. That's one example. At that time we called EWOS, Electronic WOS. And that was Atlas coming from Renner from Germany. So I was not so happy, but we want to have a convention. One was, why you create another one? So, but anyway, the WOS is ended. There's no leader to carry on. CF came along, they introduced their new convention. So start from CF 1.1, whatever. The people try to make comparison between WOS and the CF. So CF getting bigger and bigger, getting drawing more attention. And occasionally they were referred to WOS. And when you look at CF 1.1 or 1.2 web page, which maybe no longer exists, they will refer to WOS. They will say, this is the exchange in WOS. But when the time passed by, they totally forgot their father. No, it's just, I'm an adult, I don't need WOS. So in the newer version of the CF convention, they almost forgot about what they said in the past. Okay, so right now we're 1.6, and I do remember they suggest all the variables got to be in lowercase. They suggest for human eyes only because human eyes easy to read lowercase instead of uppercase. Okay, so there's a kind of confusion about convention carry on from after WOS ended. So everyone just follow CF. So CF and also ARGO as well. So right now that the two big convention people recognize. Either ARGO or CF. GDPP, we had a lot of users. But we didn't get go out to make commercial announcement, say this GDPR convention. So, but gradually those three are become into really similar convention at all. And I raised this issue to CIS DataNet maybe 2 years ago. So there was a brief discussion to bring this compatibility issue to IoT, JCAM, Ocean Data Standard, and Best Practice Project to make a proposal, to OSDBP, which stands for Ocean Data Standard Best Practice, which became a program right now. As I said this afternoon, with one, there are two people next door, they are part of the ODSBP. They are two leaders on that one. So there was some discussion to bring this to an upper level attention, say, no, in the ocean community, we need to make this as a standard, okay? Which I did raise this issue last week among GDPP and other projects. Because you will make the CDF, NetCDF convention standardized, that will make everybody life much easier. So right now, you still have to struggle with dealing with so many different format conventions. But we will see, we are working on it. Okay, so this is the CF metadata website, and you can take a look, you have a PowerPoint, so you can study later on. So the CF requirement, they suggest, actually they say must, but I doubt, they say, okay, we follow their rules. The file name must have .nc as a surface. Okay, end with .nc. Okay. As I said earlier, the CF attribute that take a string variable must be 1D, one-dimensional array. Okay. Now the naming convention, you got the variable name, dimension, attribute name, must begin with a letter and composed of letter and digits and underscore. That's fine. But cut B begin with a letter. Okay. Yeah. So dimension name must have different dimension. The dimension of variable must have different names. You cannot have the same name for one dimension. Okay. And now you have to specify that your convention equal to CF-1.6. You declare your convention is compatible with CF-1.6. You have to say CF-1.6. Okay. So without going into detail for the following slide, I will move to a little bit faster. Okay, this is the CF convention. You got to have exit. I don't think you have to know the detail yet. Now, it's just for your information. Okay, so there are different types. You got a data point, one single measurement. A different type of time series. The time series means a measurement was collected at a fixed location over a certain period of time. That's called time series. Trajectory is the data point along one-dimensional curve in space and time. And the GDPP is belong to number 4, profile. It's a set of point along a vertical line. So you got one, it drops something. So you make a measurement of the ocean from the top to the end of your instrument. So kind of like a profile. Or sometimes they're called time series profile. A time series profile take a named location. This is what happened. This is said I have a very remote station in the open ocean, and occasionally I come to that location, make a measurement. They say every month, the once a month, and constantly in the same location and make a measurement. That's called the time series profile, okay. And trajectory is another collection of profile which originate along a trajectory, look like Argo, and the Argo, we saw that Argo is once deployed, Argo fly around, and during their moving, it was in the ocean, they make a measurement. That's called a trajectory profile. But GDPP is belong to number 4 profile. Okay. So this is a suggestion for the ACDD. Okay. And I believe I have a suggestion. And let's go through really quick about ACDD. Typo there. You need a title. You need a summary. You need a keyword. So there's a listing. Okay. I don't want to go through the detail about listing, but this, there was a suggestion about convention. Okay. I just know. This is the which I really kind of encourage everyone or every data type to have this convention called the geospatial let mean, geospatial let max, geospatial long mean and long max. So you everyone, you every data type has this kind of comma attribute in the global attribute part of the DNSSEC. So any software, they want to look at your data, only look at that area, and no. You want to subset the GTAPP data set. This is the only area that you should only look at. Okay, so if every data type has a comma structure, and this is for data sharing, that's much easier. Okay. So this is another one, the extension. You got the comma, you got the geometrical, vertical minima, vertical maxima, and the time coverage begin, time coverage end, and so on and so forth. Okay. So this is very long listing. It's very tedious. Okay. So this is the CDL, stands for comma data language. Okay. It's a human readable text notation that used to describe the CDL file. I'm going to show you what the CDL looks like on the TV screen.
It's actually in your data directory. Anyway, it's a copy. I will show you from my server.
So just take a quick look on how it looks like. Okay, so in your data directory, you have a file called GTAPP 1333NC. That's NCDM. It's a binary file, so you are not able to see it by your view. So the way to see it, there's the utility called NC dump, called NCDUMP, right? Okay, NC dump. This means convert NCDM file to a human readable format called COMCDL. So I'm going to convert this file dot nc. If I redirect, I will pop out to the screen. Okay, this gave me first try. Okay, so that's the nc dump, which means the CDL. So I'm going to save the output to a direct to a file name called I just call temp, temp, the temporary CDL. Okay, so I convert NCDL file to a human readable format called CDL, comma data language. Take a quick look using VI, that CDL. So this is a text presentation of the NCDL file. Okay, so there were three structure, three components, as I said earlier. The first one is a dimension. The second one is the variable here, okay? And the very last one is the data. Okay, Control D. Okay, I can search. Okay, so there are three basic components. Okay, now you can read any portion, you know, around. You know, you can jumping around either from here to there, there's no problem. So this is the format, a text format of the NCDL file. Okay. Okay, so I stop here and move on. Okay, so the next one. The way to display an NCDF file, there are so many freeware available, a commercial package. On the left-hand side, there's a listing of the freeware or free software. And the first one is a CSIRO. It's the software made available by CSIRO called the MATLAB interface. Okay, it's okay for CSIRO to make this available for people to use. The question is, you need a MATLAB. MATLAB stands for Mathematics Laboratory, something. It's extremely, very expensive. And the MATLAB started back to 85 or something. And they say to students, I'm not going to complain about MATLAB, okay, so don't quote me. But I learned from MATLAB, so you want to run a business, a company, and that's the way you should go. Look like a McDonald's, okay. They were choosing meal, right? Meal kit. It's very, very small, very small, and very cheap, not expensive. They say to choose, come with a very small toy. So this kind of educational sale to the really small children. So built their concept about McDonald's. I'm not going to against McDonald's, so don't quote me. But this kind of way, MATLAB become very popular in the old day. They sell to a student very, very cheap, very, very, very not expensive. So once student become a professor or they got a job, they're so used to MATLAB, so they start buying the MATLAB. So they don't care about the price of the MATLAB. However, the MATLAB become more expensive, even become more expensive tomorrow. So the problem with the CSIR MATLAB is you need a MATLAB. So I don't have MATLAB. What I'm going to do is use all that, not useless. EPIC is another software developed by PMEO, but it's free. The software cannot read GDPP NCD at all. So they have a special purpose for special person. Okay, Query, again, the same thing, is developed by PMEO. GMT is a joint project between NOAA and the University of Hawaii. They have a special format. They can read NCD, but they cannot read GDPP data at all. Okay, NC Browse is okay. I have been working with the NC Browse with Don Dembo from PMEO. So NC Browse can be used for read GDPP data. Okay. Actually, when I designed GDPP in NCDF, I didn't talk to Don Dembo at PMEO. Once I create and I use the NC Browse, just read in perfectly. So that's okay. OpenDev, Bob mentioned them earlier today. OpenDev is just a kind of vehicle. You need to write a client software. OpenDev is a server, it's sitting there. Okay, you need to write a client for connection to a different data set, geographically distributed in a different location. Both locations running OpenDev. So user has to write a client software so you can bring two different data sets from different locations into your desktop. But again, not everybody be able to write a software for OpenDev. It's really impossible to me. And I still not quite in favor for OpenDev. You know, and someone will, they don't like me at all. Okay, because I say, yeah, great. Now I see 10,000 entries files on my screen. What I'm going to do with it? It's not so helpful to me. Okay. So the next one I call the ODV, Ocean Data View. Okay. Again, you still need to work with the ODV author to make your data readable into ODV, Ocean Data View. Which is okay, Rainer is a good guy. And the ODV is probably used in the European community, so it became popular because they have funding to keep going and going, and it's free, which is okay. So Rainer is a kind of more flexible, easy to go work with. So I've been working with him so to make sure that GDPP NCDF file is readable by Ocean Data View. The problem is using the PC version of the ODV is slowed down. They're quite different between old PC version versus the Linux version. Okay. So finally, you come down to R interface. This is kind of new. I am a programmer, and I can do program relatively fast and easy. So that's the way my personal view using R. To me, it's easy to learn, and I hope everybody should be easy to learn as well. So when you return to your institution, I encourage you, say you know how to install R on your desktop PC. It should be no problem to install on a PC in your office. And just try to learn using R. It's not so difficult to learn, to use. You can do it. Almost everybody can do it. Okay. On the right-hand side, you come up with a listing of commercial package. look at the AVS application visualization system. S3, don't mention about S3, even more expensive. IDL, I use IDL. I used to be IDL expert. No, I'm still IDL expert. IDL stands for Interactive Data Language. Okay, it's really similar to MATLAB, even similar to R. Okay, so there are the three package, the three software, MATLAB, IDL, and R, they're almost the same. Okay, and Mathematica is another one. Noise is a PP product. They are all commercial package. You have to pay. Okay, that's the big part. Okay, so the next software, you can look into the Unidata website to download, but I just take a look and you can find something useful for GDPP, please let me know. No, I spend time, I cannot find anything useful for GDPP. Okay, so that's a GDPP. Next time we're going to move to another topic of GDPP, next format. How is the format looks like? Okay, we extended the convention used in COAS. I think COAS stands for Comprehensive Ocean and Atmospheric, what R stands for, whatever, anyway. But that was at the very beginning, the COAS people had the Nestle Convention, and WOS is adapt that convention. So the GDPP Nestle formation, the Nestle GDPP Nestle format is extension for COAS and the WOS, and it's fully compatible with CF and ACCD convention. And it's backward compatible with the COAS, and such as NC Browse and Ocean Data View. Okay, so each time I make a major revision to GDPP initially, I have to ask Rainer, the ODB, to test before I make an official announcement. Okay. So this is the way we are doing right now. The naming convention for GDPP is always the begin with GTSPP to indicate this is GTPP initial format. And occasionally you will see GTPP 4 and followed by station ID, and followed by data type. And the last three digits, the first one for Q pulse, Q date time, and the B record. Actually, B record is equal to Q record, as Bob mentioned earlier, because we don't want to say Q record, what that really mean. So we call it best record. Okay. So that's the naming convention for GDPP initial file. Okay. So this is the example. It always begin with GDPP and then separate by underscore with the database ID and the data type. Okay. Now, right now, it's called TE. In GDPP, you see data type either TE or BA. That means that's a real time. The other definitely got delay mode. So you see GDPP, you see TE, or BS as part of the file name, you should know that's the real-time data. You retrieve data from GDPP database with a file name other than TE and the BA, and that's 100%, that's a deliverable data. Okay. And at the end with 111, which indicated good processing is good, daytime is good, and it's the best quality, the one indicate. Later on tomorrow, we will have one section to talking about GDPP QC flag. Okay, we use a numerical number, say 1 to 9, to indicate the quality. It's a 0, 1, 2, 3, and up to 9, to indicate the quality of the data set. Okay. But this is the way to get a quick look on the quality of the GDPP data without open NetCDO file. Okay. So this is the dimension part. Okay. Now, and as I showed you earlier in the CDL format, now this is just another way to take a look. Okay. So, we're using the geographic coordinate system, and this is the naming convention, followed by CF. But CF, this is the standard way to express the date and the time. As ISO 8601, ISO stands for International Standard Organization. And then, so there are a bunch of standards. So this assign each to 8601. Okay. So we talk about this already. So GTAPP, the variable name using lowercase, the mixed with the underscore. No. Yeah. Okay. So we talk about this. That's the history section. So right now the GTAPP NetCDF format is another way to store made ASCII format. So everything is almost identical. And whatever in the main ASCII, we will carry over to NetCDF. Okay, so that's a different format, a different way to distribute data format. Okay. Last week we had GTAPP meeting, next door. Right now we have GTAPP NetCDF version number 4. And we are working into, and there's still some issue with the NetCDF number 4. Because as I said, NetCDF right now, GTAPP NetCDF is another way to present main ASCII. So there are a lot of code in the main ASCII file. It's carried over to NetCDF, which is not so useful. Because I have to look into the code table to understand the meaning of the code. So it's still a big headache for the most user. Or I actually say for the most advanced user. You people like to know the detail about how this data set has been quality controlled and by what, by who. They have to look in the code and open browser, go to NODC or Canada website to look into the definition about a particular code. Okay, so this is still a headache for most users. So for the next release of NetCDF file, we are moving to another format which will serve both the exchange among the GTAPP partner and also using that format to distribute. So that format has been well designed, not just carry the GTAPP code, but also will display the meaning for that code. Look like ACCS, we know that ACCS stands for accession number. So we will give explanation about that code, ACCS, what does that really mean, and so forth. So all the And we design a new CDF format. We want to make 100% that will be backward compatible with all the other software. Okay. So this is the way that I showed you earlier. To read GTAPP NetCDF file, there's one tool called NetNC dump utility. It's really handy for a quick look at the metadata and the coordinate variable. You can just NC dump -h. So again, now you don't know how to use NC dump. You don't know what's the option. Now you can do. You always say NC dump space -h. Okay. Sometimes you have to say NC dump space -h and help to bring the help menu up to online. So using NC dump display coordinate, there's a lot of options. Now you can say NC dump -h. C to display the header only or coordinate. NC dump -h will display the header information. And there's a bunch of other information or option available for you. We don't have to go to detail about NC dump right now. Okay. So we already did that. The using exercise explore using GTAPP NetCDF file by using NC dump. Okay, which I already showed you earlier. So we skip this exercise number 7. Okay, there's a bunch of options. You can play with that one. We have break at 3, right? Okay. Is anybody already logging into the server? Right? Did you log into the server yet, Jim? Okay, try to log into your server. And I will just let you play with maybe 5 to 10 minutes. Okay. So when you log into server, I work from here. I allow you to give a feeling about NC dump and for different option. Okay, I leave this window open, and I'm going to, I log, already log into my server, my account in that server. Okay, so go to data set, go to data directory, I'm already in, and using double arrow, long listed, star.anc, looking, is there any anc necessary file in the data directory, which I believe there is some. So log into this, log into your account, and change to gtraining data directory. Oh yeah, I forgot to copy over. Okay, this only in the US user 09. So what you have to do? Okay, this is what you have to do. Log into your gtraining and cd to data. So after you log in, you should be able to see USR as a 0123458 and at sunrise, which is the server name for that machine over there. So this is your home directory, right? So once you log in, okay, I will walk over, make sure everybody log in. Anybody log in? Okay. Out of that, you see cd to g training / data. Okay? Okay.
I'm going to tell you how to copy the data what's in the local network. So right now, we are copying on that machine. So I'm going to tell you how to copy the data I already put on the local network.
Okay, so make sure you are in the gtraining data directory. Okay, otherwise you will copy to a different directory, and then that's not my fault. Okay, so watch carefully what that type. Say cp, okay, / home, / usr 09, which is the account I'm logging right now, / g training / data / star. Let's copy everything. Enter USR g train USR 09 g training data directory to my current directory. So after star, you should put space and dot. Period. Okay. So when you finish, just let me know. But I let it walk through, make sure that you. So this means the command means I'm going to copy all the files and the user 09, which is I'm looking right now, and with directory and the G training and the data, everything in that into my current directory, that's called dot. Okay, once you finish.
You're missing an N training.
What do you mean?
You're missing an N in G
training. Oh. I don't know, yeah. You're very good eyes. Okay. Yeah. Good eyes. Okay. When you finish, just no, it won't hurt you. Just press enter. I'm not going to copy again because I'm not going to copy to myself. And if it's just asking you want to replace, and just say yes. Just type lowercase y or uppercase y. Doesn't matter. Did you copy? Start copy. Okay.
It may take a while because everyone comes at the same time. Okay, done. Okay, that's right.
No.
It's not something on the form. Don't do anything. Yeah, okay. You are not copy, you are And the system will ask me, you say, skip, ship, ship, ship code, and ship code. So I will tell you another trick.
Because last file may be required in the later on. So once you do that, they will skip two directories. The first one called code, and second one called ship code. Okay, we'd like to copy that over again. So what you have to do, I said the most simple way to do, and we will learn something new, is do this. Enter the data directory, you make another directory. Did you remember what the command to create another directory? I said to make, and you say what? M-A-K-E, right? So the unit is lazy guy. Instead of saying make, they just say M-K. So M-K directory, M-K-D-I-R, allow you to create another directory called called ship. Okay, let me say. Begin with code. Oh, no. No, code. S. So, what you have to do, enter your data directory. Okay, you want to create another directory under Linux, right? So the command you will use is what? Make directory. So it's mk. Make. Mk. Mk. Dir. And we want to create two directories. So the first one to create is codes. I already have one, so I don't want to hit it. But you go ahead to tap mk space codes. That will enter and you'll create another empty directory. After you do that, you create another directory called ship code. I believe it's called ship code. Okay, so you create another one called ship code. So mkdir space ship code, either one or two space is fine. Okay, and then we'll create another directory called ship code. Okay?
Okay. Yes. Okay. So we are good. Okay. So you,
the next task, you will copy everything under the USR code directory. So you cd to the codes, the directory called the codes. Okay. Now you don't have to tap whole thing using your mouse key, arrow key, and move up. Oh, I didn't do that. Okay, let's do this way. You say cp home usr09 gtraining and the data course / start to here. But be careful, you have to change it to codes directory before you type that command. Okay? Because you want to copy everything under the codes directory to your directory.
Okay, so I like anyone to look in the data directory, and you should be able to identify at least one or two file has the NC is ended with NC.
So you should say LL, or that's fine, or LS, that's okay. Start. I'd like to take a look if there are any file NACD file in my data directory, which we should have. So right now you see there are two, the one called GTAPB and the one called temperature.nc, which supposedly that's yesterday I allowed you to create that one, but we skip that one. So right now I allow you to use NC dump to just follow the instruction on the slide. Okay. The task one, just get a feeling, say how this work, NC dump. So what you have to do, just type this line at your screen from your command line and see what it looks like. Okay, it's type NC dump -C to display coordinate variable.